and stand for the reading of the gospel. You want to look in your worship Bible. This is from Luke's gospel, the 20th chapter, verses 9 through 20, and that's on page 1054. Beginning with verse 9. He went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. And he sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. And then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love, because they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, "God forbid." Jesus looked directly at them and asked, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, and anyone to whom it falls will be crushed." The teacher of the law and the chief priests looked for a way to arrest him immediately, because they knew that he had spoken this parable against them. They were afraid of the people. Keeping a close watch on him, they sent spies who pretended to be sincere, and they hoped to catch Jesus in something that he said so that they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor. The Gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Are you tired? And about, oh my gosh, I got a whole hour extra to preach according to the clock. You think you're tired now. This is one of those texts that is intended to Lent. It's intended to push us closer to the need for the cross. So this morning we will continue to look at what it means to each of us in our daily lives. As we continue to make our way towards the cross with Jesus, let's remember that this journey, what this journey is all about. It is because he loved us even when we have rejected him and killed him in our own ways. He was willing to do what he could so that we all might be saved. So believe in him then, and cast yourself upon him, who is the cornerstone of our faith. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, your word today is life. It falls on us sometimes hard, but yet, Lord, in it you show us your great love. So bless us now with this word. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Well, some of you may have had the occasion to read some of C.S. Lewis's books. Mere Christianity is very popular. The Screwtape Letters, of course. And then the delightful Chronicles of Narnia, which the Lion and the Wardrobe would be familiar to many. If you're familiar at all with C.S. Lewis, this English writer, this Christian apologist, has a form of logic which he has shared, which we often repeat because it's good for us to hear. He says that there is nothing more important in your life than knowing the truth about Jesus. That there is nothing more important in your life than knowing the truth about Jesus. This is truth. If it is false, you see, Jesus is either a liar or a lunatic, and it is of no importance to us. If it is true, though, that Jesus is Lord, it is of infinite importance to our life. The only thing that cannot be is that it is only a little bit important. It's going to be either or. And this is an eternal peril. We are in eternal peril of ignoring it. Again, I'll just do it one more time. Jesus will either be a liar or a lunatic, and it's of no importance then. But if it's true, Jesus is Lord, and it has consequence for our lives. We're pushed into a position where we need to choose between those. If Jesus didn't actually walk out of the grave on Easter morning, fine. Then don't bother wasting your time with it anymore. Reading Plato or Aristotle or any other ancient thinker will be equally as valuable. But if it's true, well, in that case, you see, it's different. In that case, it's quite different. I mean, Jesus then would be Lord of all. He would be the creator of the world. He would come to earth as a human being to redeem us then from our failures. He comes to earth to offer us eternal life. He offers us the chance that everything that was bad that we've done would be cleansed and forgiven. So if yes, then, this is true, coming to faith in Jesus Christ will be the most important thing we ever do. In the context of this reading for today, this parable, unless you are willing to admit that you are not the master of the vineyard, and that's our problem, and throw yourself on the cornerstone, who is now Jesus, and be broken, then the owner of the vineyard will come. The owner of the vineyard will come. And as we heard the scriptures, the people replied, and so do we. God forbid. Well, let's look at that gospel reading, if you would, for today, that parable that we have. We have to set it in the context of Luke's gospel there, the 20th chapter. We are already in Jerusalem, okay? We are headed towards the cross. Jesus will be moving quickly then towards his trial and crucifixion. But right now, Jesus is teaching in the temple courts, and we are way ahead of next Sunday. Palm Sunday has already taken place because Jesus came into the city riding triumphantly, riding on a donkey. People were laying their cloaks down in front of him, waving palm branches and shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." And they are quoting Psalm 118, verse 26 when they are doing that. And literally what they are doing is that as Jesus comes into the city in this form, he is fulfilling the prophecy of who the Messiah will be and how that will happen. And these people who are out there in this mob of enthusiasm are saying, Jesus now is the Messiah who is coming. And that, by everyone who is a part of the authorities of the church, the religious leaders and the political leaders, is a problem. So we come to this part where it says that the song, these Messiah, will also be the same Psalm 118 that we reference, where it is that the stone of the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And so today's scripture and the song and the Palm Sunday reading of what the people are saying come together. This is important because it's the size of the crowd, it's the enthusiasm of the crowd, it's what they're saying that is what will bring the authorities against Jesus. And at the very end of today's scripture reading, you have that portion where it says, well, now they begin to plot, right? Now they are putting spies out there with Jesus. And all these things are moving us quickly towards Jesus' death, crucifixion, or trial and crucifixion, torture and crucifixion and death. The parable of the vineyard is a very familiar to anybody of that day. When Jesus said it to them, they knew exactly what he was talking about. He's talking about us, the people of Israel. Talking about the covenant relationship that God had established with the people of Israel. That God would bless the nation of Israel abundantly. That God tended to it, you see, and gave it everything that was needed so that it would grow in numbers and in faith. And all God asked in return is that they would believe, first. The second is that they will obey his word. The third is that they will return to him the spiritual harvest out of their lives. That's all. But rather than being grateful for the abundance of his grace and giving him his due in return, they proceed to rob God and reject his messengers, the prophets. An interesting thing, I think, that when I was doing some of the research back on this, is that when you start to list all of the prophets, both major prophets and minor prophets, and how they were treated, I mean, it is an interesting list of how it was that the people of Israel, and Jerusalem in particular, treated the ones who God sent. For us, though, I think the good news out of this text is that one of the most amazing parts of the story is the landowner. He doesn't give up on them as they deserved. Instead of after the first servant coming and taking care of the issue, he continued to send servant after servant. And in the very end, he sends his own beloved son. This only speaks to us, I think, of God's patience and of God's immeasurable love for us. In the season of Lent, then, as we contemplate what it means for our daily living, it is Jesus who is making his way to the cross. And the religious leaders, they know that they are plotting against him, and Jesus knows every intention here that's going on. And if I might be so bold then this morning, I think the parable then speaks to us in this particular way, because it's not only the religious leaders, but it's us. We are so much like the tenants, you see, ones who are renting the land. God has given us so much, yet we take it for granted. Not only do we take it for granted, but we want more. He sends people to ask us to give him what is his due, and yet we reject those messages in selfish attempt to keep even more of what we think we deserve. And what hurts him, I think, what hurts God's very heart, is that we, step by step, fall deeper into sin. Moment by moment, we transfer our trust not to God, but back to ourselves. And even as we sin as the tenants here, God remains faithful and continues to send his servants in the hope that we will abandon our plotting and that we will turn to faith and let faith be the center of our life. The ultimate result then is that we would come to God and accept that message for us. Well, the last thing I want to leave you with is this, is that when Jesus quickly turns from that parable, he says, well, what is this about the stone that the builders rejected that has become the cornerstone? What is that about? He's asking them. Some of you are builders. You know something about building homes and houses and the like. And I remember being up at Concordia College when they were building several new buildings that were there. And they would have a ceremony, and they would set the cornerstone. The cornerstone always had the date in it, and it had a few other things. In ancient times, when we didn't have laser levels and exact measuring things and things like that, the cornerstone was the very most important part of the building because it provided the foundation and set the building into its proper proportions and directions. That cornerstone was essential for the foundation to be strong, for which the rest of the building would be strong. And the choice of it being used in the psalm, and then as Jesus references that psalm today, is that Jesus would be the rock, the cornerstone, by which the whole foundation of Christian faith would be placed. And that stone would either be the one for which we are broken upon, or would break those who don't believe. So it comes pretty important, doesn't it, that we ponder that today? But to fall upon the stone, the cornerstone, points us to repentance and judgment. It also points us to grace and forgiveness. To fall upon the stone means that our life is broken and we set that aside then to receive the love and grace from God. Our salvation is one of restoration then of who we are as people. In breaking up oneself, the cause of Christ is in our lives, and we live then for Christ and for one another. So today, as we fall upon the cornerstone, who is Christ, the foundation of our faith, we are broken. And in our brokenness, Christ brings us new life and healing. And he dies on the cross in our place. So, here we go. The good news, and there is good news, is that we are no longer wicked tenants. No longer wicked tenants. But now you are adopted as sons and daughters of the landowner himself because of what Jesus has done. And we're thankful. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we continue to make our way to the cross. Let's remember that this journey, what it's all about, because you loved us even when we rejected you and when we killed you in our own ways, and you are still willing, Lord, to save us. Let us believe in you this day and cast our lives upon you, our cornerstone, our rock, and our faith. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Let's stand and join me in singing.